I really thought more time would elapse before we would have another 2.7 liter EcoBoost on the channel. But here we are, several months later, and another Gen 2 out of a 2018 F-150. Now, this is a core return, so when a salvage yard sells an engine, oftentimes they'll charge $50, $100, or up to $1,000 or $1,500, depending on how rare and what the demand is for the old engine. And sometimes you get an engine that's totally rebuildable, and sometimes you get stuff that has a bunch of inspection ports in it. In this case, I don't see any of those with this engine, but I also don't know what's wrong with it. I don't have a history on it. I don't know details, but I do know mileage. And that is one thing you guys always crave. This has 131,800 miles on it. So yes, 130,000 mile 2.7 liter EcoBoost has failed. The last one had 96,000 miles and I had more of a story with it. This one is a big mystery. The second generation of 2.7 liter EcoBoost engine puts out 325 horsepower and 400 foot-pounds of torque. That's a lot of power and torque out of a relatively small displacement engine. And in the comments on the last 2.7 turbo engine I tore down, people said that's why they fail. And I don't necessarily agree with you. I'm not saying that that's not a contributing factor, but it certainly isn't the reason that they fail. There's a whole load of reasons as to why engines fail. We've seen them on this channel over the last 3 years. And there's also something to understand about the sample size and the types of engines I have on my channel or in my shop. I target specific types of engines. So inherently, I'm going to have more of them. That doesn't mean that more of them fail. It just means that I know they do well for my business and they also do well for videos. And that's why there seem to be a lot of EcoBoost engines on this channel. The videos do well, the parts sell well. It doesn't mean that every single one of them is going to blow up tomorrow. Now, aside from the mileage and the year it came from, I don't really have any other details about why this engine was replaced. I assume it turns over because it had a flex plate with no saw marks on it. So let's test that theory. It definitely turns over. Got compression. Definitely has compression. I don't necessarily hear Uncle Rodney banging around in there. The one disheartening thing about this engine, there's no water pump. Who stole the water pump? Who takes a water pump off of a used engine and reuses it? Who would do that? The first thing we're going to do is pull the coils so that we can get the plugs out and take a look. Well, the plugs don't look terrible. Nothing smashed or broken, so I don't see any malice in the combustion palace today. But this plug right here, driver's side or left-hand bank, is really wet. And I gave that a good sniff, and that is fuel and oil. So that may be the problem cylinder. I don't know. A lot of times, too, when I get these engines back, plugs have been swapped around, and you don't really know what came from where. We've seen that multiple times on the channel. But I'm going to look at that cylinder as the possible defect. Next, I'm going to remove this EGR pipe. I assume that's the EGR valve. See how much work it is to get this off. Tons of work. The next thing I'm going to do is remove the boost control solenoid system. There's a sensor here, solenoid down there. This comes off. This comes off. We'll get to that in a minute. Yeah, I can just hang out over there for this situation. The next thing I'm going to do is start unbolting the upper plenum. Before I actually do that, we're going to get this harness off of the back of this plenum. Now we can unbolt the plenum. This should lift right up, and it does. Two things about the second generation of 2.7 liter EcoBoost, and that is that the valve covers have the intake ports or part of the intake tract built into them. And I'm not a big fan of that because that means that to do valve cover gaskets, you got to pull the plenum off, but the plenum was also really simple to get off, so I don't think it's that big of a deal. However, it does increase cost of labor and effort to replace them, and maybe there's two sets of gaskets now. again, I feel like this was just for packaging. One of the really good things about these engines, though, is that they have both port and direct injection. So you get the benefits of an injector in the combustion chamber, and then you get the port injection to keep it clean. And in the last video, I didn't show you guys that because of the angle of the ports, but I have a borescope, so we're going to take a look at that now. All right, so we're going to do my best here. We're going to start at the front on the right bank, and you can kind of see if you get down in there, will you go down in there? Well, it's not really, there we go. You can kind of see that the valves are clean. They're definitely cleaner. All DI engines get a bunch of buildup on the valves. And the goal with, there we go. See how shiny those are? That means there's no carbon deposits, and that port injection takes care of that. Of course, there's still some crud in here, but even port injected engines have some crud in there. That bank all looks good. I'm trying here, guys. Here's a better look. Look at that. Look how shiny those are. They're like new. I mean, I don't know that they're not bent, but they're like new. Now we're going to prep the left-hand valve cover for removal. No tube, but that still fought me. And there's still oil in it. That means it's not drained.
It's not drained!
Next, I need to get this engine hanging bracket out of the way. And we're going to just use blue to kind of persuade it so I can get straight on the bolts. Now we can remove the valve cover. I think I got them all. This would be our first real look inside of this thing. I don't know if I have anything I can easily pry. Oh, there we go. Crank sensor or cam sensor works great. Oh, it's clean. My biggest fear on this channel is tearing down a good engine. And when I don't see an obvious failure this far in, I get a little nervous. I mean, it doesn't mean it's still good. And what am I going to do? Sell an engine that somebody told me was bad as good because it looks good? That's not how I work. But I don't see any, there's no metal bits. There's no forbidden glitter, no sparkles. All the valve train's in the right spot. It looks good. It looks really good. Nice and clean. 131,000 miles. This one was taken care of. At least the oil was changed on time. Chain looks good. I don't see any issues here at all. Even the top of that rail is intact. Same thing as the other side. Oh, okay. Most of the resistance with this coming off are the spark plug tube seals. So I don't see anything yet. Unless I'm just missing it, which is possible. This all looks really good. Perhaps the oil filter will make me feel better about pulling this engine apart. Well, folks, there is a smidge of glisten in here. It is not a lot, though. A couple flakes here and there. I mean, some metal in a filter is bad. And any amount of metal that you find in a filter, it's not good. But it's not like this thing came apart and it's just loaded up. It's just not like that. In fact, I didn't even see the metal until I got the light on it. It's just, I wonder what we're going to find. Where did that come from? Next, we're going to work on the front timing cover. We'll start cleaning this up. wonder if that's going to make a mess when I get that unbolted. Got my bucket underneath it just in case. Couple drips and I'm making a bigger mess by not paying attention to what I'm doing. The oil cooler looks pretty good. And the oil that's in it does too. Belt tensioner. Idler. Now the harmonic balancer. Will the little stubby do it? I think so. I think we need the other one. And we're off. While we're here, next we have just a few 13 millimeters. Now time for some 15s. Now I need to take the bolts that hold the pan to the timing cover out. Those can stay in, and at this point, it looks like this cover can be popped off. I don't remember what it took to get the other one off. I think it took the brakes being on my engine stand. Haha, nope, nothing yet. Let's just give it some taps. I don't know if I'm doing anything, but it feels like I'm doing stuff. This side looks like it's looser.
Now we're getting somewhere.
And what will we find in here? Oil! A lot of oil. Well, we can see our oil level now. It's a first for the channel. Here's the inside of the timing cover. Looks pretty good. This looks pretty good. Now, I don't know. I always thought that the new style of phasers were the sealed, where the spring wasn't exposed, but maybe that's just a 3.5 thing. I'm sure you Ford guys can chime in. There's our rubber belt that drives the oil pump. It's a thing I don't really like very much. And there's our oil. There looks to be some debris in there, but, well, I don't know. There's some sparkles in that there oil. It's really hard to tell. But if you look at the very small crevasses of this rail, you'll see a little bit of metal deposits that aren't supposed to be there. Not terrible. Obviously, metal where it shouldn't be is bad. Next, I'm going to turn this engine over slowly. Let me see what happens here. I mean, without oil pressure, this thing's going to move back and forth anyway. I kind of wanted to show you guys how this operates. We're just going to turn this over. So you can see the level of oil, and it sloshes oil. You can see it's pumping oil out here. And I'm making a big mess. We better drain this thing before I get too carried away. I'm not sure if I can do this by hand. Yeah. Oh, if I do that too much, it's going to go all over the place. It's definitely quicker than a normal drain plug. I'd still rather have a regular drain plug. Oil doesn't look terrible, but we did see some metal in it. Yeah, it looks a little gray and hazy to me. We're going to let that drain for a minute. We'll come back to this in a little while. Now we can start peeling the timing system off. Start with the tensioner. Hopefully it's not under too much pressure. Oh. Whoa! Looks decent. I can pull this rail. Looks pretty good. Late 2017, there's a date code right there. This is excellent. It's a great shape. You could totally reuse this. This one also looks good. Same date code, or close to it. Yeah, nice. Let me get this chain off. Look at that unit. Yeah. Now we can take this side apart, but I can't get the chain off because of the oil pump drive belt. Standing back. A little bit of oil came out of there. Tensioner looks good. It's under a little force. That's an original piece. Looks excellent. So does this. Actually, this is starting to come apart. I haven't seen that before. That's the first signs of major issues that I've seen. So I believe this is a first for the channel. That looks melted. That looks like a temperature-related failure. But how would that happen? It does have its outer coating. I mean, it's not like it's missing any parts. And the rest of this looks pretty good. But that area is falling apart. That's a new one. Now I think we can slip this chain off of the cam gears here. We'll just let her dangle. Now we're at the rear of the engine. We're gonna start tearing this side of it down. We'll get the vacuum pump off first. This needs a little help. See, blue has many uses. That all looks good. Actually, that O-ring's a little deformed right here. I wonder if this thing overheated. Now we'll start heading towards the high pressure fuel pump. And this is a kind of a crash part, actually. This is on a lot of cars where the fuel pump or fuel line could be crushed or pinched in an accident, and this is there to prevent that from happening. It's supposed to prevent a fire. Now it's time to remove this rubber hose before you guys all tell me I need to remove this before it annoys all of you. So we're gonna do this the right way. Get the clamp off. It's like a loaded gun. I should have yelled timber first. Any fuel in there? A little bit. I wonder if I can pull this housing with the pump. That's what we're gonna try to do next. All right, something has happened. I don't know what, but something has happened. Look at that. Oh, we got fuel all over this place. So there's the roller. Rolls on this cam lobe. Spins good. Lots of fuel. Now we have some pesky fuel lines. One of the things I really like that Ford did is they put these little tethers on here so that you can't lose these clips, which I bet would be easy to lose. Nice and easy. And that's out of the way. Now we have just a few fuel lines. When I say few, I meant two. Last thing I'd like to do back here, remove these coolant lines. They are O-ringed in. They do not want to come out. That's the trick. Before we go cramming those caps off, I'm gonna pull the variable valve timing solenoids. They have a habit of collecting metal if there's any metal in the oiling system. Well, these certainly aren't laden with material. There is some debris, however. It's not terrible though, and that could be just dirt and debris from the area in which these were installed. Now we have reached that critical part of the show where we need to cram the cam caps off. Well, the journals and the roller rockers look excellent. There's some bubbles of maybe water in here. Could be moisture from the engine sitting. When I did crack these cam caps loose, they did spray some fluid out of them. All the rollers feel good. Everything looks really good. Starting to get a little worried here, guys. A little bit of damage there, but it's hardly even worth mentioning, this is a very pretty full set of cams. And the caps look really nice. I feel like I'm taking apart a good engine. I don't like that. Time to crack these head bolts loose. Got one wire harness to pull off of here. And I think the head should just lift straight off, right?
Probably not.
I kind of remember having to pry these heads off. We're gonna try to lift it off first. Yeah. The dowels were quite something on this engine. Wow. It's unbolted. I swear it's unbolted. I'm going to thread one of the head bolts back in so we can break the seal. I think that's what I did last time. All right, so we're going to use my little bar here. I think we're going to use this. Obviously, I got it off the other engine. Well, I broke some stuff. It's fine. We didn't want that anyway. Hey! Got it. That's not really what I wanted to happen. And I have created a situation for myself. It's fine. At least I think it's fine. Why is it not? Okay. After just a little help, now the head should lift right up. Well, I see some problems. I don't know if that means it's a bad engine, though. Head gasket doesn't look terrible. I don't see any place where coolant and oil and combustion could meet. Looks okay. But there is some not so good sauce in this cylinder. That's not what you want to find. This was the cylinder that had the wet plug, so we got a problem here. First two cylinders look pretty good. This one, however, has a cocktail that you never want to find in a combustion chamber or in a cylinder. This is coolant and oil mixed. It's a bad combination. It means bad things have happened. But how did it get there? So here's the head looking front to back. There's one, two, yuck. I'm going to get this cleaned off and see if we can see any damage. At this point, I've got most of the junk fluid out of this cylinder. And one thing to note is how the pistons look. They all look the same. And if coolant was entering the combustion chamber, especially while it was running and hot, then coolant would have steam cleaned the piston and they wouldn't all look the same. As well, the bore looks really nice. I don't see any damage here at all. Let's go look at the cylinder head. I cleaned that up quite a bit. So I combed this over pretty well, and I didn't see any cracks or any reason that coolant would have entered the combustion chamber. And yes, I know this one's cleaner. I used some brake clean and a little Brillo pad to kind of knock all the grime off of it. But I don't see any issues. And I don't see anything here either. So how did that get in that cylinder? Before we get too far ahead of ourselves, we must do our scientific test. That one came all the way up. That one came all the way up. Uh-oh, come on. I think they all come all the way up, so I don't think we've got any bent rods. We don't know that yet. All right, we're gonna try to do this with a straight edge, see if this head is flat. I still don't think that that mixture got in here because of a head problem. And I don't see any air gaps underneath this. Let's see if we can get you up a little bit. I don't see any light through there. This looks good. I think this head is flat. Time to crack the other side loose. You know what helps when you get all the bolts out? Much better. Well, these journals look pretty good too. All the rollers feel nice. I don't see anything wrong. Not liking this, guys. Cam looks perfect. Virtually zero wear on these cam caps. Time to crack the other side head bolts loose. Thread one of these back in a little bit because we know what's going to happen. I don't know what I did to get the other side off so easily, if you want to call that easy. So we're just going to try some stuff. What? That was really easy. No. This should just lift right off now that I've got it broke free. Oh yeah, okay. Well, I think we found the problem. And I feel about 800 times better. So there's your head gasket. Looks good. Let's do our test. Rocks in the bore pretty well. Also rocks that direction. That's kind of odd. This way makes sense because of the wrist pin. This way makes no sense. Like how? Can someone explain what's going on here? I'm sure when we get this apart, the other ones really don't do that quite so much, but that one does. Take a look at these bores here. There's a little bit of rust along the top edge. I would call that rather insignificant, but there is some pitting in there. I wonder if I can feel that. Let's see. Well, it doesn't wipe away, and I can kind of feel it. Definitely going to need some attention. A little bit more moisture on this side. That piston is suspiciously clean, and I'll show you why. Starting at the front of the engine, this one's super sooty. Like it might have been misfiring, running rich, or maybe its neighbor has a burnt exhaust valve. Yep, that's what happened here. So obviously this had zero compression in this cylinder, ran with a miss, and because it wasn't firing, fuel washed the piston and the combustion chamber. The question is, did the shop find this issue, and was it priced based on the cost of an engine, which they are not cheap engines, versus repairing the cylinder head, because I think you could probably repair this head for $400, $300 to $400. The other question is, why did it burn a valve? Before we flip this over, we're gonna remove this water pipe and manifold just to get it out of the way. What the what? Will you? Where's blue? I need blue. Ah. Fixed it. An 8? Come on, Ford. While we're here, we're gonna get these motor mount brackets unbolted. Now, I know what you're thinking. Eric, the little pitting you found in the one cylinder wasn't that bad. I bet the short block is perfectly fine. I don't think you should take it apart. That's not what we do here. Now we can finish unbolting this lower plastique oil pan. Let's see how this comes up. Can I just pull on it? No, but I can pry on it. We're off. All right, now inside the pan, there's definitely some sparkly stuff. You never want to find sparkly anything. This kind of film, metal-y film, it's not terrible. Obviously, we've seen worse, but anytime you have any signs of metal in an oil pan, it's cause for concern. This is probably my least favorite attribute of these engines, the plastic oil pan. These are one-time use. You cannot reuse these. They are a source of common oil leaks for these engines, from what I've read. You can't even check the screen inside the pickup. I did that on the last 2.7 I tore down, and I obliterated it with a hammer. It's really kind of a shame that this is where cost-cutting gets you, and I understand they're quieter, but when you buy a truck, is quiet the name of the game? How many people would rather have a louder engine and a steel oil pan? I know I would. Now onto the second thing I don't really care for on these engines, the oil pump drive belt. Now, this is a pretty common thing in late model Fords, and I'm not going to tell you that they're all going to fail or it's all going to be a problem. If you have a 1 liter EcoBoost, then yes, I would be concerned. But I haven't seen anything else break. I don't like the idea of it. I know that the Generation 1, the Gen 1 2.7 had a chain here. And normally I would tear this all apart and we'd tear this oil pump apart, but I'm going to save the oil pump, the belt, I'm going to save this gear and this sprocket here, because eventually I'll get another 2.7 Gen 1 engine in, and I'd like to see if I can retrofit these parts onto the Gen 1, which means that I could then retrofit the Gen 1 parts onto a Gen 2, and I'm pretty sure that there's already a company that makes a chain replacement for this belt. But anyway, we're going to get this oil pump off and then we'll check out the condition of the belt. It's that easy. All right, here is the moment of truth. Let's zoom in a little bit more. This is the oil pump belt. It is a Kevlar belt. It's not just rubber. And there are several concerning areas on this belt. It definitely looks, there's a big one right there. It definitely looks worse than the 96,000 mile one I tore out of the other engine. There are lots of cracks and splits. The sides, I mean, obviously I can flex it and open up all of the problems. You can see that there. The real question is, how long before this becomes a problem in the truck? Now, this is not a thing that I would be super concerned with right now. I wouldn't go racing out to replace this, but it's one of those things that if you're in there and there's a chain option, that is the direction I would go. And the real thing is, what is the maintenance interval for this belt? Is it 100,000, 150,000 miles? Is it even mentioned? And now Ford has come out and said, in some instances, that like in the EcoBoost, the 1 liter EcoBoost, that they take special oil, but I don't think these trucks take any kind of special oil. So if you use the wrong oil, there's a big crack right there. If you use the wrong oil, does this belt degrade faster? And there is something else to consider about this belt as well. It's not just mileage. with this, because this is wet with oil all of the time. It's time. So is this an every 10-year thing? Is this an every 15-year? And what are these trucks, what are these belts going to look like when these trucks are 15, 20 years old? And let's look back 15 to 20 years from now, and what kind of trucks are out there, and are people fixing them? And the answer is yes. People are still fixing three-valve trucks. People are still driving 20-year-old trucks. And this is going, this may be a major thing, and it may not be. Yeah. Definitely worse shape than the last one. Now, this is one other thing I don't like about this engine, and that is, if you were to replace that belt, it would require you to retime the engine, because the belt drive is between the two gears that drive each chain for each head. And I understand that's because of the way the engine is built. Like, I get that, which is why I don't understand why they went with a belt. Other than maybe it was cheaper. Either way, if you could replace it with a chain, that's what I would do. Speaking of chains, my God. Now we're going to slide these right off. And I'm going to keep at least these pieces with the oil pump. And I'm going to keep the belt, all of this together, because I will get another Gen 1 2.7 in. And I'd like to know, can you swap parts over? Now, onto a part that I really like about this engine. Look at how ridiculously overbuilt this block is. This is ridiculous. Even if one of these chucked a rod, I don't think you would know until you tore it down. This is, it's impressive. The casting is really nice. Now we're going to get all these bolts out and remove this lower block half. Unfortunately, it is how the engine is mounted to the stand with half of the bolts. So things may get a little sketchy. Let's see how tight these are. Yep, that's not going to happen. That did not pan out for me. Now I have to unbolt the block from the stand. It's going to be okay, I think. See, one out, it didn't even flinch, but this one, it's going to flinch. See, I watched it flinch. That's not sketchy at all. No, just two bolts right next to each other. It's just, don't look at it. Don't look at it. I said, stop looking at it. Now that it's barely held onto my engine stand, the next thing we're going to do is start prying on things. Let's get this rear main seal plate loose. Will you come out of there? Okay, whatever. You're fine. Just stay there. I think this comes off pretty easily, too. Yes. And let's remove the lower block. And let's remove the, nope, let's get blue. The sealant they use on this is no joke. It's a lot of aluminum there. I just wanted to show you guys how intricate this casting was on the inside. This is a pretty interesting block design. One thing to note that I haven't seen on other engines is this has fractured main caps. Not machined, but fractured. I don't really see any cause for concern. There's no discoloring. We didn't really see a ton of metal in this engine anyway. Next, I'm going to take all the rod caps off. We'll crack all these loose. We're going to do all that before we push the rods and pistons out. We'll get the crank out, and then we can push the rods and pistons out the top. It's fine. Now we're going to crack the main caps loose. Oh, it doesn't weigh enough and it wants to slide. It's amazing how easy those are to come out. And now the crank should just boop right out of there. Boop. I'm going to pull the rest of these out here. Go ahead and get these out while we're here. We're going to turn this back over so we can push the rods and pistons out. And drain more oil. And drop the thrust bearings. These come out nice and easy. Let's start out with the rod bearings. They're perfect. Like, perfect, perfect, perfect. And the reason they're red is these have a coating on them. It's like a low friction coating. Some other auto manufacturers do this too, but there's no damage whatsoever. We'll jump right into the main bearings. Very minor wear. You can even see the little code that they manufacturers, UPC, whatever, SKU, hologram, I don't know what you want to call that. There's a word for it, and it's just not in my head right now. Let's get to the rods and pistons. So the reason they're shaped with this offset journal like this is so that you can get them in and out of the bore. Otherwise, they wouldn't fit because the journal size is too large. Pistons all look pretty good. I didn't see any damage. I didn't see any cracked ring lands. There's moderate wear to some of the skirts, but no gouges, nothing like that. And in the last video, I mentioned the way the rods look, and that's because the top of the rod is superheated so they can install the wrist pin. See, that doesn't rock so good. I mean, it's like too loose. Maybe it just needs oil pressure. I don't know. A little bit of wear. Here's the piston out of the cylinder with the burnt valve. As you can see, it's a lot cleaner than the others. But again, I didn't see any damage. All the rings are free. Nothing is, it doesn't look terribly clogged up. These all look pretty good. I think it gets more wear as you get towards the back. I wiped these down a little bit. Maybe you can just see the wear better because they're clean. Really not bad. This is the most complete engine we've had in a while. As you'd expect, the crankshaft is perfect. Unfortunately, Ford cranks don't have a ton of value, but I'm not going to throw this in the scrap bin. I think this engine might be best as a builder. Not sure. Let's take a look at these bores. Most of the cross hatching is still very visible. Clearly some moisture sat in this engine, and there's some staining, a few scratches. You can see water or something was sitting right there where the piston sat for an extended period of time. There's minor wear. That's probably the worst one there. It's really not that bad. I think this would all clean up. That's probably the worst of it there. I think this would all clean up with a dingleberry hone. I'm not going to dismantle the entire cylinder head, but I would like to look at that burnt valve. So let's go ahead and knock that loose now. That did it. I'll actually flip the head back over so we can look at the seat as well. Don't mind that sound. Well, there's the valve. There's definitely some material missing, and I bet it went right into the turbo. Probably took that out too. We didn't get turbos with this engine. or a water pump. And the seat doesn't really seem to have sustained any major damage. It's still obviously going to need a valve job and a valve. And I don't know what the rest of these valves look like, but that's the only one that's that way. And just to do it, put my straight edge on this head. I don't see any light through there. So I don't know if this engine was overheated or not. And if it was, I don't know if it was bad enough to do any head damage. I have questions, and I'm sure you do too. I want to know a lot of things, like, was this truck stock? Were there any aftermarket modifications? Was it tuned? What kind of gas were you running in it? What were you doing when this happened? Were you towing a trailer? Were you doing 120 miles an hour? How hot was it outside? How long had the truck been running? There are a lot of factors here that can cause a burnt valve, but heat, obviously, is the number one thing. And we don't necessarily know all of those answers to the questions that I just listed. So it's hard to say whether this was an issue with an injector, an issue with a tune. It could have been a bad tune, or the scenario in which the truck was put in. Did somebody put the wrong gas in it? There's a lot of what ifs in this situation. So it's really hard to blame this type of failure on the engine because we don't have the whole story. The rest of this engine, beautiful, in excellent condition, looks really well maintained. That's what kind of makes me think it might have been a modified truck. Typically, people who modify their vehicles take better care of them. Of course, they beat on them and abuse them, but they're also the first one to change their oil on time and to replace parts as they fail. In the terms of neglect, you don't usually see those vehicles as beat on. I'm not going to say it doesn't happen, just been my experience thus far. So now is the biggest question. Besides the fact that I don't know how that coolant and oil mixture got in that one cylinder, I don't have an answer for that. But if this truck came into your shop, would you fix the engine or would you replace it? One head getting rebuilt, essentially. Maybe if you took both heads off. I don't know how hard that is in the truck. I would imagine that's a cab off job. But these engines are $2,500, $3,500 plus. And the rest of this engine was in excellent condition. So what would you do? Would you repair this engine or would you have replaced it? In most cases, the teardown, the cost of labor, and the replacement parts, all of the while you're in there stuff, can easily exceed the cost of a replacement engine, especially considering it's such a new vehicle. There's a plethora of low mileage engines available. Either way, this was an interesting one, and it wasn't that bad. We don't always have to have engines that bombs went off on the inside, although I know a lot of you guys like that stuff, and I'm sure there'll be more of it as we move forward. I'd like to sell parts out of this thing. Maybe I want to sell this as a complete builder. So if you want to build a 2.7, I think I have parts from the last one. I can combine everything, or if you want to buy individual pieces, I'll do that too. Whatever you guys want. But if you'd like to buy parts out of this engine or anything else I've torn down, or you want to buy parts out of this 120,000 mile 97 LX450, it's a real shame. It's not that nice. It runs great though. I'm going to leave our email in the video description. You can also go to importapart.com. I've been uploading our parts cars just about every single week. I really hope you enjoyed this teardown as always. I love all the comments, all the feedback, and even the criticism. I love it all, and I'll catch you on the next one.